welcome to this, the second big Live and Sweaty for this season, and have we got a testosterone-packed evening for you tonight. We've got AFL, we've got Rugby League guests, we've got guests coming out of our ears. Be careful, that does reflect. Ray Hadley is with us tonight. We've got Steve Roach, who is, for those of you who aren't in League States, is a former Australian front rower. Blocker! Blocker! Why do they call him Blocker? Well, front rowers are notoriously... No. Or as we would say, refreshingly uncomplicated. We've got the 12th man, a.k.a. Billy Birmingham, standing on live at Eastern Creek, scene of this weekend's great big 500cc World Motorcycle Grand Prix Championship. And with him, we have the star of tomorrow night's big concert down there, but who is playing for us, especially on Live and Sweaty, here tonight with Billy Birmingham. We have Jimmy Vines with us! Plus, we have all of our normal... Oh, perhaps that's not such a good choice of words. Abnormal friends and family who you've learned to love and talk about behind their backs as time has worn on. But perhaps the biggest sporting controversy that's happened this week is the absolute furor caused by the league's decision to stage a rugby league match on Good Friday. Did you hear about that? Well, the church is in absolute uproar about it. No, they are. The church say it's sacrilegious. They say it shouldn't be done. They say it detracts from the absolute religious significance of what Good Friday is all about. But I'm actually not so sure, because the way you see it, right, you've got two teams playing, and from, if memory serves, it's Easts and Souths. It's always in plural, right? And one of them has to lose. So I haven't been here very long, but the way I see it is, if one of them has to lose, that means you've got 13 blokes who all think they're Jesus Christ going out to be crucified. Right? And then you've got a coach that's got to resurrect them to play another match the following week. Boom, boom. But tonight's controversy corner question is... Ah, you see, you forgot your lines. Should captains be responsible for the on-field behaviour of their team? Well, we went out and we asked someone who isn't.
My favourite girl, I can't believe it. What a surprise.
How are you, Michael Whitney?
I want to know who paid your airfare up from Melbourne.
I walked. Actually, listen.
Was that my box that fell out? L, don't show the world that, please. Hide that.
Should a captain be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of his team? Now think about it, because it's a big question. Should a captain be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of his team?
No.
Not, why not? Why is he captain then? Is
just
that what...
Just a name that they give him. C. They put a C next to his name.
Yeah?
Sometimes that doesn't stand for captain.
You know, nerve Husey on the behaviour.
I thought that was just a bit of Chewy that got caught in his mouth and he...
So what's the captain's role then? What's the captain's role if he's not responsible for...
Move the field, make the bowling changes, work out the batting order.
Have the wife to organise making the cakes for the party later.
Yeah, see what they're going to have for lunch.
Yeah.
What sort of beer they drink after the game.
So it's not really that...
Not that bad a job.
No, when do they
I reckon we could do it.
You easy. Think?
Share it, yeah. As long as I filled it first slip and you could open the batting.
I think I'd like to be at... Silly mid on.
What about short leg?
What about off stump? Oh, that Michael Whitney. I think we're going to have this dreadful problem all night. Now we've got a very special. Get your hand off me. Either that. Or lower. We've got a very special attachment to Live and Sweaty tonight. Now, you may know him as the 12th man, but to us, he's our very special cultural attaché. We're going straight out to Eastern Creek to Billy Birmingham. Oh.
Yeah, g'day, Elda. Billy's not here at the moment, love. I'm really sorry.
Oh, look, it just happens to be Daryl Eastlake.
Yeah, no, listen, Sorry, love, Billy's been caught short, darling. He's out the back having the snakes. But well, listen, love, not to worry. The big D's here, so let me tell you what's been going on out here.
I'll tell you what, you're looking very impressive, Daryl. I mean, it looks fairly breezy out there and your hair hasn't moved an inch. It's absolutely rock solid.
Yeah, well, thanks very much for noticing, Princess. And I'll tell you what, talking to you, darling, it's not the only thing that's rock solid at the moment. Listen, anyhow, enough of that. Let me tell you, we have had motorbikes coming out of our arseholes here today. Oh, gee, Fanny.
Oh, gee, Rainey almost came unstuck on that corner.
Yeah, thanks very much, Dave. Piss off with it. OK, as I was saying, Al, we have had bikes of every description out here today. We've had big ones, little ones, red ones, white ones. Oh, gee, look at that huge black one! Oh, gee, sensational stuff! Oh, gee. Unfortunately, though, they've all been doing this mindlessly, going round and round in circles, following each other around all day. Oh, gee, talk about boring, and the noise has been deafening. The whole place stinks of petrol and smoke. Oh, gee, I think I'm going to spew! Oh, geez! Oh, gee, that was close. I just managed to hold that one in. Oh, gee. Hey, I tell you what, if you're coming out here this weekend, though, Alan, you don't like motorbikes, you are dead set in for a shithouse time.
Oh, God.
Hi, Al.
Oh, Billy, hi. How are you?
Sorry I'm a bit late. Thanks for Big D for taking over there for me.
That's all right. If a man's got to have a slash, a man's got to have a slash.
Absolutely.
We all know that.
I'm glad you agree with that.
Yeah, no worries. So what's the atmosphere like out there?
The atmosphere is pretty much how the Big D described it. There's lots of bikes and leather and smoke and noise and all that sort of crap.
Oh, well, that sounds like a bike race to me.
That's a bike race.
That's the only time when a man will actually admit that size does count, Billy.
Absolutely.
So what, where...
We got lots of mongrels here.
Where exactly are you, Bill? Oh, let's all join in, shall we? Scream, everyone. All right.
I'm standing in the middle of the big, big stage out here.
Yeah.
And inches away from me is our very, very special live and sweaty guest for tonight. He is my good friend and neighbour, the Wayne Rainey of rock and roll, Mr. Jimmy Vaughan.
Hi.
It's a wee bit difficult to talk to you.
Well, I know.
These
hens
out here.
Well, these young boys, they came out
as
a visit.
I know, but listen, how are you doing?
I'm all right. And it's good, 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 good to be.
I speak Scottish, so I just asked him, Jim, how he was doing, and he said pretty good things.
So listen, Jim, the new album Heat is coming out on Monday.
I'm sorry, I haven't got time to interpret everything. You'll have to look up your Scottish dictionary at home to work out what Jim and I are saying. Mate, I probably should vacate the stage now. Jim will let you guys get to it. Jim's going to perform a couple of songs for us tonight.
You probably should, Billy. Wait a sec, though. Last year, you gave me such a boost to the credibility by letting me sing on your record.
Thanks,
mate. I mean, I've noticed it's rubbed off. I've seen people in the audience actually laughing at the gigs now. It's really big.
That's good.
I'd like you to stick around, maybe do a number with us.
Tonight?
Do one right now.
Have you got a weapon for me?
Have we got a weapon for you? Look over here, pal.
Beautiful.
All right.
Jimmy, let's go to work. Let's go to work.
And there's so many lies.
Gracious me, Billy Birmingham and Jimmy Barnes will be seeing more of those fellas a little later in the show, but now I think it's time for some decorum as we cross straight over to the World Sports Desk and the very blonde, very bloody skinny Karen Tai. Karen.
Good evening, everyone. Well, in rugby league tonight, Balmain have sacrificed an early 10-0 lead to go down to the Raiders at Leichhardt Oval. Canberra levelled 10-all at half-time, went ahead by just the one thanks to a field goal, and then took the match with an intercept try in the 78th minute. Here it is.
Edmund took the ball up, looking to offload a pressure pass here. He was trying to throw it his own.
The AFL season proper got underway tonight at the MCG between Footscray and Collingwood. We've got a three-quarter time score. Collingwood are 13 points ahead of Footscray. Are you happy about that?
I'm very, very, very pleased about that.
Well, that's good, and we'll bring you the full-time score a bit later.
Oh, thank you. It's okay, go on. Please, go on.
Unfortunately, no vision, but we will try to get some vision from next week's game. OK, well, basketball is back in town. In fact, it's happening right round the country tonight with the pre-season Kmart Classic. Matches have been played tonight in Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide and Perth. There's a lot of them, so let's rip through the scores. In Sydney, Newcastle have defeated North Melbourne, and just 1 point in it between Sydney and Illawarra, but that was a short time ago. We'll update you later on. Down at the Glasshouse, Canberra have beaten Melbourne by 13 points, and at half time it was South East Melbourne over Geelong. In Adelaide, the Gold Coast had a good win over the Canterbury Rams. They come from New Zealand, if you didn't know that. And Adelaide 60 at half time were leading Townsville by 8. And at the Perth Entertainment Centre, it was a short time ago Hobart over Brisbane 76-51. And that's it from me. Just a quick update from the world's, not the world, the Australian Swimming Championships in Perth. Yay. Kieran Perkins has taken gold in the 400 metre freestyle. And Susie O'Neill has taken her fourth gold in the 100 metre butterfly.
Oh, yeah.
there, so that's very good. And actually, tomorrow, if you tune in, halftime in the rugby league tomorrow, I'll be speaking to Kieran Perkins and Glenn Houseman and having a chat to them live.
Glenn Houseman be pissed off? Well, don't you think?
Yeah, I suppose so. He came second tonight in the 400.
He'll be spitting chips. Don't you? I'm very pleased about the Mighty Pies, though, Karen.
Well, that's great. I hope they keep it up and win.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Shall we?
Okay, one, two,
three. Wow! Fabulous, and I can feel something else coming on. Yes, it's time for that magnificent skull of rust, a Debbie Spillane.
Voila!
Elegant, light of foot as usual.
Elegant.
Yes.
Morant L, Anna Corella, all of those sorts of things. What's been happening in sport this week,
Deb? It's been a very weird week. That's the only word I can use to describe it. A weird, weird, weird week. I mean,
was it weird?
Yes.
Oh, it was weird.
I think you're onto it. I think you're onto it, Elle. I mean, firstly, we had Mark Woodford actually picked to play for Australia in the Davis Cup.
And secondly, of course, I think he actually won. Even weirder.
Yeah. And now we've got to face the fact that Queensland are probably in a winning position in the Sheffield Shield. Mm. Now, that's weird.
Oh, please.
But there's more. Somebody actually had Johnny Young in jail and they let him out.
That's very weird.
I mean, I really just don't know what could happen from here. Anything could happen. I mean, Greg Norman could win a major. Bruce Reid could get fit and stay fit. Pat Cash could get a real job. I mean, I don't know. We could even have the Sydney Swans vaguely resembling a football team the way things are going.
Oh, no, that's just silly, Debbie. That's just very, very... In fact, though, something else weird happened. Did you read in the paper?
No.
Bouncer, the dog from Neighbours, died of terminal cancer. Oh. You'd think they'd have the rest of the bloody series checked, wouldn't you? It's on its way out.
Yes, I think so.
But these things do happen in threes, so fingers crossed.
Yes, well, we should get away from soapies and to the real, real world of sport. And I think first in the weird things that have actually happened, we should have an update on the ritualistic male bonding that goes on in a celebratory sense. You know, we looked at it last week. The World Cup final, the World Youth Cup final, rather, last Saturday night. If we can have a look at the highlights there, we can see that the Ghanaians have continued to work on their set moves post-goal.
Yes, here we go,
Anne. Look at this. They're getting better. Look at this.
Oh,
yes. And go, boomps-a-daisy, 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 boomps-a-daisy. Look, class and flair and imagination does win out in the end, because this is something very different. I don't know what you call this, maybe turf surfing.
Dear me.
Someone suggested to me that they might sort of get a bit of stimulation out of that.
Do you think? I don't know. It wouldn't be any worse than carpet rash, I suppose.
Don't know. Things happen. But I did have a dog that did something like that once, and they told me it was eczema, so I don't know. But weird things have been happening in cricket as well. I mean, I don't know, there's a very strange vibe about Mike Whitney's comeback for the, you know, in time for the Sheffield Shield final and the Ashes tour. I mean, things are weird and they haven't even named the Ashes team yet. But
he looked all right when I talked to him.
Yeah, he looked all right. But I don't know if you saw the footage from his first grade comeback match in Sydney last week. I want you to have a look at this and see. He's a bit paranoid, I think, and I don't really think he's, you know, I think he can...
Well,
understand
no one there,
it. No, there is somebody there. Now, just have a look behind where he's bowling. The only people there are the Highway Patrol.
Oh!
I mean, I don't know if they're trying to pin something. Apparently, they see, the guy's just getting out. They breathalyzed him after every over, apparently.
Well, with that wonky ankle, I don't know whether he could walk in a straight line.
No, well, they were telling him to bowl in a straight line as well. So he's feeling paranoid, and I don't... You know what they say? Just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they're not trying to get you.
Oh, well.
We're with you, Mike. But that's only relatively weird compared to what's been happening over there in New Zealand, where we've been playing cricket as well.
We're talking about New Zealand.
I know we're talking about New Zealand. But I want you to... I was very disturbed. I think some of the lads are really showing signs of stress over there. And these highlights from Sunday night concerned me deeply. And I think you'll feel concerned too when you see them. Now, this bit's fairly normal. Mm. Now, you'll see the team are coping with difficult conditions there.
Yeah.
It's
Dean Jones.
They've got the willies up.
Yeah, it's David Boone.
Oh!
for herself.
I don't know who it was. My initial first reaction was, now, who would you expect in the Australian team to do that sort of thing? But I just noticed he was sitting on the bench there. I would have thought it was Merv Hughes, because they tell me he often gets a bit rambunctious. And if it had, and it's a pity that it wasn't him, because there was a great line in there, because it would have been sort of sheep on a spit or something like that.
Oh, well, doesn't matter. We tried.
Yeah, we should get out before the gumboot jokes. What do you reckon?
Yeah, and the gaffer tape, I think so. Yes, very okay. Important. So we'll see a controversy corner?
Definitely.
Absolutely. And... oh, I'm sorry. Yes, absolutely. But, gee, the very exciting things happening, of course, the kickoff of the AFL season this weekend with Collingwood leading at three-quarter time. But now a man who's going to take us through perhaps the intricacies of a more subtle side of the sport, something that goes on in the mechanics, something that actually makes AFL football live and breathe. We go down to Melbourne now for a very special report from the good doctor, Peter Crackers Keenan.
Football's been good to me. For 13 years I was a player, but one mob I hated, and that was the AFL Tribunal. So for the good of football and mankind, I've decided to fix them up. They got me 7 times. And if I don't fix them up, I'll get more good men. Over the oval, up the stand, and in. This one's for David Rees-Jones. I can smell you, boys. I can smell you. Now a goal to Keenan. This is it. We're here. No one's home. In at last. You all thought it was a bomb, but it's worse. It's a curse given to the Keenan family 500 years ago by a Haitian princess. All these ingredients are secrets given to me by my father's grandfather. Baked beans. Make you easy on a summer's day. Look, in there, little boys. Curry powder from the Himalayas. One whiff of this and you're dead. In it goes. Onions. Kill people with just one bite of these. In you go. And worse, bratwurst sausages made in Germany before the Second World War and kept on the rock ever since. Sacred chicken. Red in a farm at Boomanumla, only fed rotten grain. Well-bred, won the Melbourne show in 1966. Here's a curse. Hero, hero, I'm home to stick a bubble in a zip, bang, bar, golly, woggle, stick to the blue in the blue. Yeah, can pick a girl of whiskey, shelly, shelly, hey. Wiggle, woggle, wiggle, woggle, zip, bang, bar. Flatulence, flatulence, bar, bar, bar. The members of the AFL Tribunal are going to cop flatulence for the next 30 years. Every Christmas Day, this is the Keenan curse. Stick it. I'm out of here. I won't know it's me, but I think it's Graham Corns. You little ripper!
Crackers Keenan, I think he's off his rocker, or perhaps he should just be sitting in one. Now, when you come up to Sydney and you switch on the television, you're most likely to be bombarded with a series of commercials known as the Lowe's ads. Now, these commercials are for a local menswear chain, and they are conclusive proof that footballers should stick to football. They've obviously taken these guys, they've sent them off to NIDA for a few acting lessons, and they've detoured via Taronga Park Zoo. For those of you who haven't seen these ads, just take a little look, you'll see what I'm talking about.
Oh, sensational!
Oh, you look pretty good yourself, Walker. Only 99 bucks!
Amazing!
Woolworth business suits, only 99 bucks.
And Lowe's!
A Woolblim business suit, only 99 bucks.
I'll go Twinkle Toes.
Oh, Julius Marlowe dress shoe.
Not 90 bucks.
For 59.99.
Paramount business shirts.
19.99.
Can you believe this?
A Woolblim business suit, made in Australia.
Only 99 bucks.
At Lowe's! Why are we tap dancing?
Was the hooter sink?
Paramount.
Paramount business shirts, would you please make welcome two of the stars of these aberrations of television, Steve Blocker-Roach and Ray Hadley. Make them welcome. Down.
Thank you, Elle. Thanks for the very kind words about the commercials.
That's your...
Oh, sorry, I just lifted your dress up.
Well, Mr. Roach, you...
Plenty of room here, darling. What's going on here?
Oh, I'm so sorry, sweetie.
The big man, I'll drive a big car.
Apparently. So I've heard. You look a little bit like a grown-up version of that little round kid from Hey Dad.
That's his son. I wish I had his cash.
You're using more toilet paper.
Oh, thank you very much. Now, I hope you can... You are... Now, take your hand away from me. You don't have to be defensive.
Well, it's just that the last time I was with you... No, we won't go into that, but anyway.
If you don't mind giving away trade secrets, I won't give away yours, Mrs. Hadley. Now, tell me...
You told her. You said
now,
you wouldn't.
Oh, no, sorry, mate.
Hush, desist.
Okay.
Right, now... Let's get into formal interview mode. So tell me, no. These commercials, like, you're obviously stars in your own right. You're commentating, you're playing. But how much recognition do you actually get from them, from the commercials?
Well, we've both been offered major parts in movies.
Oh, yes. What, Conan the Thickheads? What? Which ones? Which ones?
That was supposed to be a secret.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, honestly, how much recognition do you get?
Well, it's really embarrassing when you when people start saying to you, oh, you're that bloke on the Lowe's ads, aren't you? Not that you played footy or anything like that, I mean, I think...
Well, no, that's what I really find very sad about Andrew Ettinghausen. They're not going to be saying about him in all these years, you're the bloke that played all these tests for Australia. They're going to be saying, you're the guy who they showed his... You know, that's one of the...
$100,000 an inch, too, that's pretty well. You can't sue me, can you?
And from a teammate... And from a teammate that's obviously straight from the horse's mouth, so...
She's smart, eh, Ray?
You said that. No. Okay, so tell me, Ray, as a commentator being involved, how did you actually get in them? How did they choose you? Did you have to do any stringent audition process?
Or? Yeah, we auditioned.
It takes about a year to get in them.
Yeah, we auditioned. It was fairly stringent. We auditioned on a Tuesday and got them on a Tuesday afternoon. And... Well, first of all, I think it was Paul Vorton, Michael O'Connor, myself and Stephen, we used to do them, and other footballers were involved as well.
Yeah.
But Lowe's were a major sponsor of our football coverage, and that was how I got involved in it.
Right.
But it is a bit disappointing because I've been calling football for 7 years and sports director of the radio station TUE for 10, but no one knows me from
Except
TUE.
Except for the Lowe's
end. No one knew what he looked like because he's behind the microphone all the time, so now they know what he looks like.
Oh, right.
Got a bad ad, hasn't
he? Well, let's have a look and see what he looks like. We've actually got some more of these ads. They're coming up now on the screen, just to give us a feel.
$100 to $120. Full blank business. Single, $99.
Nice shoe. Leather.
Julius Marlowe, $59.99.
How simple, Barley. A wool blend business suit.
$200.
$120. At Lowe's.
She likes me.
$125. Quick, to $99.
Look what you're standing in.
Julius Marlowe, leather shoes. Half price.
Plenty of stock.
Oh, my God.
I mean, it's sad that Paul Vorton's not part of these commercials.
He's not committed anymore.
No, he's not. But, I mean, people said it was because of Channel 9 and TUIs. In fact, what happened, Stephen and I are doing a Correspondence Night, of course.
Yes.
And
I can see that.
Tell him to spell it. I bet you can't.
And Paul wouldn't do it. But that shoot, Paul went out with that shoot for 3 weeks. After that. Almost, they were looking in the window at jewellery shops at one stage.
Oh, well, that's the other thing, of course. Paul's been usurped. And we've got a new member of the team. Gary Freeman. Oh, he's going to hate me by the man.
Where is he?
Well, I don't know. Where is he?
He's not committed.
No, he's not committed, mate.
Well, he said he's got
He's playing tomorrow, I think. He's playing for East against West at Campbelltown, so he can't be here.
Who cares?
Well, anyway, he's not here, so I think that's an ample opportunity for us to talk about him behind his back.
Oh, really?
So what's he really like?
Well, he wanted to do the shoot commercial.
He's a little twerp, really, isn't he? He's a halfback.
Well, Block, I wouldn't say he's a twerp, but he is a New Zealander.
And he's a halfback.
He wanted to do the sheep commercial too.
I don't know. I reckon I reckon a halfback's better than being a 5'8". I'd hate to be a fraction of a man. but honestly, so Ray, as a commentator, obviously doing these ads and mixing with these boys on this level, it gives you some sort of deep insight into the incredible workings of their minds.
Well, it's helped credibility, I think. I mean, that's the most important thing, learning to tap dance and...
we'll never get another job in our lives, mate.
Water skiing and talking to sheep. I mean... I don't have any problems.
And riding horses, don't forget
riding
that
horses, yeah.
I'm surprised you left that out of the...
riding the horse. I've got another clip coming up just in short, but I just wanted to... did you understand what I said? Did you understand that?
I only look Greek.
Oh, right, sorry. So I wanted to ask you...
It's one all.
You've got some... Have you developed any special skills?
Of course.
Which is, what, like?
Rollerblading, horse riding.
Have you had to have any voice improvement lessons or any... No, I didn't mean that personally, but, you know, Warwick Capper did elocution
you
lessons.
You can't say that.
Warwick Capper did elocution lessons.
No, that'll be him.
Do you have to do anything like
no,
that?
No, there'll be none of that going on for me, I don't think.
No, elocution.
Yeah, spell it.
Oh, please. They're a double act. They're so intimate they could be an old married couple. Let's go. Let's
who told you?
Your mother. Now, so let's have a look.
Oh, no. No, please.
This is a fabulous one.
Oh, no.
How embarrassing.
Combination overall, $35. $29 for this bib and brace. You pay $40. You're up, your face. Pink guys. Don't be wankers. Work shirts only $19.
Now, we have to say thank you, we have to say goodbye, but we do have a controversy corner topic coming up very shortly.
Yeah, Ray will be on that.
You'll be on that?
Well, okay. You've got to go home.
Yeah, yeah.
He's got to go home. He's got to go home, apparently. Kathy.
Aren't you committed?
Yeah, I'm committed.
Would you two just shut up?
Some Lowe's people here.
Apparently, Kathy, Steve's wife, plays Lowe's commercials while he's away from home so the kids don't remember who he is, but it backfires. It backfires because they're so embarrassed when he comes home, they go, Daddy who? But now it's time for something else that's very interesting. Now, Australia has been at the forefront of world surfing ever since Captain Cook first crashed the Endeavour and boogie-boarded into Botany Bay. But there is more to this magnificent sport than just sun, sand, surf, and the back of a Sandman paddle van, apparently. So we're now going to cross very much live to Gidget on the beach. Thank you both.
Thanks. Green iguana, open door, walk right in. I'll fit you right inside my skin. You see a cloud, I see a rainbow. We're both looking out the same window. See the clouds drifting by, full moon rising with the tide.
Damien Lovelock.
Hello, how are you?
World's leading expert in surfing culture. Damien, what is it about surfing that keeps bringing people back to the sun and the sand?
It is a very beautiful, serene, tranquil kind of a place to go, I think. Mm. You know, especially, and also, depends when you're there. If you're there Monday to Friday, when everyone else is theoretically off at work, it's a really different place to being here on a weekend in Christmas time and there's 100,000 people on the beach and, you know, it's all like some huge Gidget movie out of control, but we're all doing it together.
She was a fabulous surfer, of course, Gidget.
The best, I thought.
Forefront of women surfing.
Never saw her fall off.
Never, ever.
Never once.
And her pigtails never once came out of their bobbles.
Well, in old Gidget language, you're a wahini.
How dare you?
No, it's true. I wouldn't make that up.
What's that?
That's a girl.
Show me this thing that draws you here. What is it?
It's like a symphony of elements. Sky and surf, sun, wave.
Bits of plastic decomposing
garbage
on the beach.
Yeah. Dead bird bodies, ocean outfall. It's that just ever-changing canvas of colour and life and movement.
It's sort of like a Berber carpet ad.
Yeah, that's like Izzy Dye's hair.
That's my only problem about going into the surf, that I'm afraid the peroxide will go green.
I remember when I was very young and people used to put Ajax on their hair around the sort of days of the surf shake.
Yeah.
And all those wonderful
What's
things.
What's a surf shake?
A surf shake is a double shake because you double everything around.
And you used to get a cardboard headband with it that said surf shake. Yeah, yeah. It was just a double milkshake that cost four times as much as two singles put together with a cardboard headband.
What are other surf foods?
Chips, if you've been surfing in winter, there's nothing like chips that are so hot they blister all your mouth, but you don't notice for 3 hours because you're totally anaesthetised from the cold. You know what happened to Gidget?
No.
They put oil wells all over the beaches in LA, every single one of them. So the whole dream's gone.
So it only remains in the songs of the beach.
Brian Boys. Wilson, yeah.
I'm going to go get a wave. So you just stay here, right? And go and get a pie and chicken roll and stuff. Fold the towel up a couple of times. Don't go to the toilet. Not cool. See you when I get back.
Okay. Has it ever occurred to you that the Chico roll anticipates McDonald's by 10 years? No dripping when you eat it?
Just get the food and don't eat it. Okay? Jeez, I went off. Where's my burger? You are dropped. And I even got to keep the mood ring. Aren't I lucky? And I've got some very important news here, two pieces of important news. First up, Collingwood, 17-13, 115, have defeated the hapless Footscray team, 13-17, 95. Carapies! Oh, my boys, just call me El McFeast McGuan. And the other bit of important news is, this is the fellow over here just dobbed in, this is the man that actually writes the Lowe's ads. Give him a round of applause.
Thank you, everybody.
You're a very, very sick boy. But we've got something that will make you much better because we're just about to cross back out live to Eastern Creek and Billy Birmingham. Standing by. Billy.
Hey, Al.
Hey,
how
Bill.
How you doing? How you doing?
Yeah, all right.
Hey, listen, do I look rock and roll enough sitting here?
Yes, certainly.
I mean, the shades are a nice touch. I can't see anything with them. Mind you, I can't see much without them anyway. But anyway, listen, I am about to introduce, once again, the feature artist for this evening on Live and Sweaty. Featuring another track off his album to be released Monday. This is a killer cut. This is going to be a real, real big hit. It's called Stone Cold. Would you please welcome once again Jimmy Barnes and the band? Yeah! Just a few.
my friends back to the pool. They'll still be drowning out the blues. And I'm so cold in love with
out there tomorrow night, and I think we've got Jimmy and Billy coming back for Controversy Corner a little bit later on. But now, well, apart from Collingwood 17-13, 115, defeated Footscray 13-17-95, our next guest, well, she's a survivor, for goodness sake, she grew up in New Zealand, she'd have to be, but it comes as no surprise, therefore, to see that she spends her spare time trying to find the highlights of living life in a World War II concentration camp. Would you please make welcome a lady who has written and now stars in her own one-woman show, Punch Me in the Stomach, Deb Filler.
Hello.
Hello.
Exciting.
It is. A funny thing happened on the way to Auschwitz.
Oh, God.
It's a dreadful thing.
Well, I guess it is a terrible thing, yeah.
It is.
I mean, it didn't happen to me, though.
No, but it kind of happened to you because as a child of a Holocaust survivor, it kind of follows through. So you've written this one-woman show about it.
I have, and I'm on your show. It's so incongruous.
Why?
It's everybody's so funny on the show, and it's such a neat show, and you're so funny, and I think, like, well, the audience must be thinking, well, she's doing a comedy about the Holocaust. And actually, I want to really clear that up because I'm not doing a comedy about the Holocaust. I don't think that's particularly funny.
No, it's not.
And as you all know from the trial in Adelaide and David Irving and all that stuff, you know, it's alive and well. And we've got people today who are creating some pretty major disasters in the world and Bosnia and stuff. But the thing that's so funny is the characters who made it through sometimes were able to keep their sense of humour. Mm. And I think that's wonderful. I've been able to take my family, and I have a co-writer in Australia, Alison Summers, and we've written a show called Punch Me in the Stomach, which is going to be in Sydney next week.
Mm.
And it just sold out in Melbourne. And we've taken, you know, there's characters say, do you like them, darling? I just had them inserted in Paris. Aren't they beautiful?
Yeah.
You know, all these characters who come up and say things like, you know, crazy stuff, like crazy jokes and stuff. I've used that.
So you've based the show on your family's experiences, is that right?
Yeah, it was an embellishment.
This would be a pretty crazy family.
Yeah, I've also talked about how, for example, I tell the story of my family arrived in New Zealand in 1938.
Yes, what a rough draw. First of all, they were in the concentration camps and they ended up in New Zealand.
Pretty rough.
I mean, you had all the luck.
The one... I just got it.
Yeah. Sorry.
It was a joke.
No, there's this one joke that I do in the show that my mother's family arrived from Germany in 1938.
Mm.
And I say, you know, it's right on the eve of World War II with Germany. And then this German soldier walks in and says, Entschuldige mir, mein Führer, but I'm afraid I have terrible news. New Zealand has declared war on us. It's a joke. Anyway. I'm sure they were shaking in their boots.
The whole comedy coming out of tragedy, though. I mean, you really do have to look at the, I suppose, the lighter sides to get yourself through them.
Yeah.
The survivor mentality.
How do you survive? I think sense of humour has a lot to do with it.
Mm.
And, you know, anybody in any situation, no matter where you are, you know, if you find yourself on television with a couple of guys who are making really bad jokes, I mean, yes. Suddenly, you know, obviously, in order to survive.
Blocker. You survive.
Yeah, use your sense of humour, right, Al? Right,
yeah, yeah, exactly. So what would be a typical survivor conversation?
A conversation between two children of survivors might go something like this. Okay, Runya, so I'll pick you up outside the American Airlines terminal at 6.
Find Helenka and listen, if by chance I'm not there, I'll leave a message under your name at the information counter.
Fine, leave a message under my name and leave another message under your name just in case they lose it or something.
Sure, okay. And listen, if by chance you get a flat tire or you get held up in traffic, don't worry, I'll wait for you by the carousel till 8. 8:30 better?
Make it 9. But I'll be there all going well. I only live 10 minutes from the airport. But listen, in case of emergency, if I'm not there by 10, you better get a taxi to my house. It's only $20. Don't let them charge you a penny more. That's good to know. And it's Harrison Avenue in Harrison, not Harrison Avenue in Hoboken, just in case you get lost or something. I'm writing this down. And listen, in case you get here and for some reason I've been involved in a subway fire or a holdup or a flood, God forbid. But just in case that happens, the greenhouse to the right, they have a spare set of keys. I'll tell them you'll be asking for it. In case of emergency, if they're not home, I'll leave another set of keys under the mat because you never know, okay? So I'll see you at 6, hopefully.
I know these women and I think you know who I'm talking about.
Yes,
it's very true. So... therapy, is it therapy for you, getting up and doing it? Or is it therapy for the people that come and see the show?
I think more for the people who come and see the show. It makes that whole topic much more approachable. You know, it's a very hard thing. And people say, oh, the Holocaust, oh, God. But actually, you know, part of life is suffering.
Mm.
And so what is it that makes one be able to survive in situations? Some people say, I could never do that.
Mm.
Other people say, I think I could probably do that. So it's really for the audience to have that experience with me. And it's a very loving, it's very healing, if you'll excuse the expression. Do you have that expression in Australia?
Healing.
So healing.
Do you have a therapist?
It's so healing for me, you know, it's just so healing.
Dreadful New Yorkers, you've been living there for a while, haven't
Too
you?
Long.
Well, Deb, congratulations on the show. It was a sellout in Melbourne.
Yeah,
absolutely.
It was a sellout in Melbourne. Yes,
and I heard you did a bit of a blitzkrieg on Ackland Street with the cake shops.
Yes, Scheherazade. And I travel down in the show with my aunt Vippi Feldman to New Zealand. And she says to me in the show, she says, Debbie, you ordered the vegetarian? I never know whether I have the vegetarian or the steak. It's a political thing. If I order the vegetarian, then the animals died for nothing.
Deb, thank you very much for coming and sharing with us tonight. Deb's show, Punch Me in the Stomach, opens next week on Wednesday at the Belvoir Street Theatre. It's been absolutely critically acclaimed everywhere, New Zealand and Australia, sell-out tours. It won the Critics' Prize at the New Zealand International Festival in 1992.
Yes.
Is that correct?
That's
and it's
true.
Also played off-Broadway. So I really congratulate you and I wish you well and thank you very
thank
much
you,
for coming
Al.
On
thank
the show.
You, Matt.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And now, once again... Collingwood defeated Footscray. Just to hear that one more time, let's go straight back to Karen Tai.
Hello again. Well, in cricket, New South Wales may rue missed opportunities on the opening day of the Sheffield Shield final against Queensland at the SCG. Sent into bat, Queensland were at one stage 2 for 13, but fought back to be 4 for 226 at stumps when bad light stopped play. The Maroons helped along with a century by Stuart Law.
In Holdsworth took both early wickets for the Blues, Dirk Willem out for a duck.
Oh, he's got him, quick ball, so that's the end of Willem.
Drop catches though cost New South Wales. Trevor Barsby going on to post 51. The day belonged, though, to Queensland's Stuart Law with a punishing century when bad night stopped play, Law not out, on 124. To tennis now, and Australia is off to a great start in the Davis Cup. Wally Masur and Mark Woodford winning both opening singles today against defending champions, the United States. Playing his 15th cup tie, Wally Masur set the winning trend, overcoming Brad Gilbert in four sets, his third win in nine meetings with the American.
Played well today, especially those last two sets. I guess, for a while, it's hard to say how Brad plays. He's always tough and he makes you play a lot of balls, but I felt really good those last couple of sets.
Against David Wheaton, it was a tentative start for Mark Woodford, going down 6-3 in the first set. Woodford, though, would come back also in four for his first Davis Cup win.
You know, the pressure's on them. They're 1-0 down, now they're 2-0 down.
Ray may have sent some riders slip-sliding at Eastern Creek this afternoon, but not before American riders dominated in practice for Sunday's Australian Motorcycle Grand Prix. Kevin Schwantz on a Suzuki picked up the fastest time of 1:31.2, almost half a second faster than the Yamaha of compatriot and world champion Wayne Rainey. Australia's Darrell Beattie claimed third fastest time, while the injury-plagued Michael Doohan, who won here last year, finished back with ninth quickest. Now, repeating in the rugby league tonight from Leichhardt Oval, Balmain have gone down again, this time to Canberra, 17 points to 10. West's Anise to the match of the day tomorrow, and to give us her tip on that one and the rest of round three, here's Debbie Spillane.
ABC Super League tomorrow features Wests at home to Easts. I'll have to take the Magpies here. I went to the Easts-Norths match last weekend. It was about as exciting as the second 2 weeks of the Waco Siege and just as conclusive. West have added a dash of attack to their dose of discipline this season and should be too good. Sunday's top match could well be Penrith and Canterbury. The season's only 3 weeks old and already the Panthers have had more scandal and injury than an episode of E Street. Their future could be looking a bit East Street as well if they lose this one. I'll stick with the informed Bulldogs. Match of the round involves Brisbane taking Parramatta on a guided tour of their new stadium named after a bank. Which bank? Well, does it really matter? They're all automatically associated with long queues, half-hearted service and hidden charges. Great name for a stadium, eh? Oh, and they will be selling red tape instead of streamers. Broncos to win. In other games, I like Illawarra, St George, Norths and Newcastle. Karen.
Thanks, Debbie. And I suppose you've already heard from Elle, who won in the AFL tonight. It was
who
the Magpies.
The won.
Who won, Elle?
Who won?
Collingwood. 17-13 to 13-17. One of those spooky scores there from the MCG. So we've got a lot of AFL fans here tonight. Okay, let's just go through all those basketball games. We'll just put up the winners up on the screen now. It was Newcastle, Illawarra, Canberra, South East Melbourne, Gold Coast and Hobart. So I hope one of the teams that you support are in there. In the closing minutes, well, Sydney went down tonight, unfortunately, to Illawarra. So unfortunately there. And the other teams and matches are still in progress now. And just quickly repeating some of the winners in the swimming championships, Kieran Perkins, Susie O'Neill, Scott Miller, a second gold tonight, and Nicole Stevenson also gold in the 200 backstroke. Oh, I'm sorry, we've forgotten a very important person in our program, Crackers Keenan, with his AFL report. Sorry, Crackers.
Thanks, Karen. Well, she's on again. Fair dinkum football. North Melbourne versus Brisbane Bears. North to win that one. Geelong versus St Kilda down to Catland. They'll purr that one in. Hawthorn versus Melbourne out here. They'll win that, the Hawks. Carlton versus Fitzroy. Carlton always win the first one of the year. And on Sunday, the interstate mobs. Well, the Crows should beat Richmond. The West Coast Eagles always win over in WA, and they will beat Essendon. Thank you, Australia. Back to you, Karen.
Thank you, Crackers, and we'll see you shortly in Controversy Corner. Well, that's it from me. Now it's over to Elle at Manly, asking whether captains should be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of their team.
A rugby player's neck.
Excuse me, sir.
Elle McPhee, Mr. Premier, is that right?
That's correct.
Tell me, I wonder if you could help me, because I am new in the state, and that's why I thought I'd come straight to the top to get the answer to my question. Should a captain be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of his team?
No.
No?
No, no. The captain obviously must try and maintain the discipline, but in any team there are individuals, and if the discipline breaks down, then you can't particularly hold the captain responsible.
So Merv Hughes, just say he did spit. That's not AB's fault.
Well, you can't blame Alan for that.
No.
I mean, after all, I think Merv would be a handful when it came to Alexa in the dressing room, so I don't know.
You might get a tongue in a very...
Well, anything could happen with that big moustache, and you'd, Alan Border is not such a big guy.
If the team respect the captain, will they therefore fall in line with the rules that he sets? Do you think it's a matter of reverse respect? It's not so much the captain being responsible, it's respect of the team for the captain?
Yeah, there's a lot in that. Again, if the captain
very
has
deep.
The... You are very deep. This is one of my most in-depth interviews I've ever had.
Thank you so much.
And I think
Jeff
you're
going to...
Obviously,
that to me.
Obviously, Jeff can't. Yeah.
Except he put his hand all over
my... Oh, no.
Excuse me. Adam, met a Colonel Lovett's wedding. You look like Johnny Platton. Do you believe captains are responsible for their the antics of their players on the field?
No, I think each player's an individual.
Well, everybody just runs out in the ground and everybody's a captain.
Yeah.
What about discipline?
Well, I like it with a bit of bondage myself.
Bondage? By the time he reaches a certain level, it should be up to the individual. And if it happens that a guy steps out of line, well, I think that's when the captain should step in.
He should be responsible. That's why he's made captain, isn't it?
The main thing of a captain is to keep his player's mind on the job.
Al,
hi, Al.
How are you? Thanks for joining us. Tell me, should a captain be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of his team?
Yes.
In all respects?
Yes.
Where does his influence stop the captain's responsibility?
It depends what team you're talking about.
Oh, he's a hard nut to crack. What about in
the cricket?
You made
me smile.
I did. I'm sorry, I've spoiled it.
No, it's okay.
Okay, so what about in terms of politics then? Can you draw any comparisons?
Politics and sport don't mix, you understand that.
Oh, but they do. Politics is sport. Sport is politics.
Okay.
Don't you see that? Don't you see
how nationalism... I do now. It's the way you put it, yeah.
So you've learned something?
Yeah.
I'm glad. Now,
you
take that, and I'd like you to use it.
I
and
will.
Wish you all the best in your future career.
I'll be different now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
What are you waiting? The role of a captain out in the football field, or any kind of field for that matter, is he responsible? The captain. He's out there, tosses a coin.
Yes, he's responsible.
What about off the field?
And off the field, he's responsible for everything. If he's going to take on the job, he's got to be
responsible. It's a 24-hour-a-day job, as you're concerned, all year round.
Yes, all year round.
Should a captain be held responsible for the on-field behaviour of his team?
Absolutely.
What about on the footy field?
Right.
If you've got your team, yes, let's get closer. I do feel intimate with you.
Thank you.
On the football field, if you have a player that, say, wrestles...
Are we Aussie rules or are we...?
Aussie rules, okay. Let's say, since we are at a Swans function. If you have a player that wrestles... Is the captain somehow responsible?
Absolutely.
How should he be held accountable?
Tag team with him?
Well,
you should join him in a tag team wrestling?
Mud wrestling.
Mud wrestling.
Would you be in that?
Or baked beans?
Would you be in that?
No. I'll just commentate.
Would you do that? Can
Would
I hold you,
be in you
to that?
No, I'll just commentate.
Well, if you commentate, I'll be in it. Is that a deal?
But you'll be in the mud.
I'll be in the mud. You can commentate.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Deal. A Gold Logie Award-winning suggestion that was from Ray Martin, and he suggested it, so we've done it. Look down there. We have the Elle McFeast collagen and liposome-induced mud treatment ready for any takers who want to take me on. And isn't it silly of me not to offer that when Blocker was on the show? But more of that coming up very shortly. Now, in future weeks, maybe we could find someone to wrestle. We'll have to draw up a draw for it.
Draw up a draw. You've been hanging around.
Wrestle Ray Martin. That's the way to go.
Oh, he doesn't want to. He wants to referee it. But I reckon...
He likes to watch.
Oh, he does. Well, apparently.
A bit like that, you know.
Now, controversy corner question for today. Are captains responsible for the on-field behaviour of their team? So let me once again introduce our panellists. On this hand side, we have Ian Rogerson from Triple J. We have Ray Hadley. And we have, oh my goodness, not only do we have Billy Birmingham, but we have my very good friend, Jimmy Barnes. Hey, Jimmy.
Contract, Rex had to be here.
Oh, Jimmy.
Yes?
Do you feel like a mud wrestle, sweetie?
You yes. do, don't you?
Is the chopper still available?
Is the well, you should have thought of that yesterday, but you'll have to come back and do it, won't you?
All right, next show.
You and someone and me and Daryl Braithwaite will take you on.
Oh, I'll get back to
him. All right. And on this hand side for our controversy corner, I've got Jimmy Barnes into a mattress, so I don't believe what I'm doing. On this hand side, we have Debbie Sculler Bruskalane, we have Peter Crackers Keenan, and we have the statue. Make them welcome. Right, who's going to kick it off? Shush, you two. Just shush. Now, who's going to kick it off? Ray, should captains be responsible?
I
want to
know what Debbie's going to say better first. Hello, Billy, how are you, son?
Excuse me, I'm in charge of this. You're
Why
going first.
Why are all sports commentators paranoid about female sports commentators? Why do you want me to go first?
It's not the question. Ray, I'm sure it's not the question.
Debbie, I've been waiting for this opportunity for a long, long time.
Excuse
because
me.
You've got poor old senile Rex on the ropes. You've been giving it to him for so long.
You just haven't thought of anything to say. We'll go straight to Ian Rogerson.
Well, it's a very, very hard question, this.
Oh, neither is he.
Mind
you,
I'm sorry,
mate. God, what happened about your skinny bloke you used to work with? You've lost a lot of weight.
Right, you want a mud wrestle?
Can I please have an answer? An answer?
No, they can't be responsible for what the players do. I mean, Alan Border didn't spit at a New Zealander.
Yes, but Alan Border sets the standard on the field.
Yeah, but he didn't spit and no one...
He was thinking about coming back to play the Sheffield Shield. He didn't give a damn what anyone was doing.
No spitting today, boys. Have you ever been a captain in a league?
Have you ever been a
captain?
Yes,
in the second
in reserve
North
grade. Yeah, knock back the job at Essendon. In reserve grade. No, in give yourself a double
undercut. Yeah. Never made a blue all day.
Crackers.
Collingwood, the 13th defeated Footscray. Don't you worry about that.
Yeah, and we had a captain there that was responsible out the ground that night tonight, Tony Shaw.
Yeah.
Not spell, but he's good.
Now, tell me.
Australians seem to be very strange with their captains. They seem most of the time to give them the worst sort of treatment possible in the fact that they re-elect them all the time. Alan Border, it should have been set adrift many years ago in
a boat in
the Pacific, but he
what
keeps
saying,
coming back
Jimmy?
All the time.
Sorry, no, I thought you were talking about captains. It was...
We are talking.
Oh, wait, oh. Can you contribute, Jimmy?
Yes, I can, actually. I reckon captains are responsible because if the players step out of line, they should actually beat them to a pulp on them.
That's good. I like that.
Sounds reasonable.
The death penalty.
That's reasonable, you know?
I'd go along with it.
Serious, you know? Like, get them off the field. If it's on a stretcher, who cares, you know?
What, Billy, you agreeing?
Yes, sir. Sorry, Elmer.
Oh, gosh.
Welcome back to the Eastern Cricket
Ground. Oh, yes,
that's a pretty awful joke, that Eastern Cricket Ground, but who gives a stuff? It's only the ABC. What do they want for nothing?
Hang on, Hayden.
Now, of course, the captain
should
be responsible.
We're not getting any. I could get more
now,
sense.
Listen.
Oh, God.
Who are you, Jim?
Would you two go in there?
Listen,
I could get
you're the captain of this. I was going to say
I could get more sense out of a block of bloody wood, so I think we might.
Speaking of statues, I noticed you
couldn't get Jimmy, put a sock in it, mate.
They couldn't find a piece of wood.
We could get more sense out of a block of wood, so I think we'll go straight to the statue, if you don't mind. Statue, just you two shut up.
Well, of course it's not the captain's responsibility. It's up to the players themselves to take responsibility for their own actions. If their behaviour's not good enough, that's the fault of their parents and their teachers. The captain's got far too many other things to think about. He's got to think about whether to call heads or tails. He's got to organise bucks turns, barbecues for the wives and girlfriends. He's got to think of the game plan, the coach's instructions. After all, as it says in the good book, am I my brother's wicket keeper?
I reckon, forget the captains, the coaches are the smartest.
Oh, here, here.
The
yeah.
the
but he's the coach's
the
representative.
Speaking, he's in. Alan Jones hasn't rubbed off at all.
That's
another
thing. It's on the edge, Jimmy. No.
Hell of a
shot. I was going to say, like, I mean, I look at an incident like that Merv Hughes thing, and I blame Simo. I mean, he's the man in charge of technical problems, and I mean, Merv has been having a saliva disposal problem,
yes.
And I think Simo should take him under his wing, get him in the nets, and you know, and sort of sort it out for him, because the coaches are the guys who are paid to take the kicks in the butt, and they're the ones who should be getting it.
Hey, listen, Al.
Yeah, what?
If you take away the saliva disposal, what happens to our golden golly competition?
Thank you for sharing that with us, Billy Ray.
Debbie, I'm just confused. Is the captain responsible or not?
I think the coach is responsible for the players. That's his job. He's there in charge of the team.
Listen, what are we arguing?
He's calling the shots. He can take people off crackers. The field.
Yeah. Their last premiership, their first burn deep, he sat on the bench all day as a captain and did a good job. He took out dressing gowns, didn't make a move all day.
No, don't be wearing dressing gowns in football. Seriously, Ray.
Jimmy.
It gets cold down there.
Listen, is Ray responsible for the... Is he captain of the Lozads or what? He looks like the captain of the Lozads.
He's having trouble with the sheep.
Or is it Blocker?
He's responsible for everything Blocker does on camera.
I try to set standards, Billy, and hope the others follow.
So tell me...
That's a captain.
Does the captain's responsibility extend beyond the football field?
Yeah, I think
no,
he
can't.
Would someone turn that bloody television down?
That was a captain's decision, that one.
Absolutely.
Okay, you're back on now, Billy. Pull your head in there, looking for wood.
He did it, Jimmy.
Turn him off, Ray.
Tina's looking a bit dusty.
Off they go.